to this panel. I'm Anuradha Agarwal, founder of ThinkNot Consulting and the host for this panel. I'm so thrilled to be sharing this platform with the esteemed panelists. And today we are going to be discussing how we can make India the next startup nation. India's economy and society seems naturally thriving every year. So what nurtures this? And we are going to draw from, each of the panelists' experience and take this discussion forward. But before we move on, I would like to briefly introduce each of the panelists to you. So I'll move to Samarendra Kumar. He's an alumni of IIM Calcutta and also King's College London. He serves as a managing director to Midcat Advisory and and is responsible for development of products to achieve its mission. De-risk client business and protect vital assets. Sam has been pivotal to Midcat's regional and global ambitions. The company counts over 50 of the top 100 global corporations as its customer. A distinguished veteran, he's the winner of Sword of Honor and President's Gold Medal at Indian Military Academy. Sam is an acknowledged thought leader, and we are so privileged to have you on the panel, Samrin. Sir, if you'd like to add something to that introduction, please.
Thank you very much. Very kind of you.
Okay, so next we have Nandini with us. I'm so happy to see more women on the panel. So Nandini, a special shout out to you for that. And Nandini has spent 20 years in the corporate career. She teaches entrepreneurship at Ivy Leagues and engineering schools around the world. She also heads a company called Karma, creating access to resources and markets. She mentors startups, mature enterprises, and family businesses. In the last 12 years, she has mentored over 5,000 entrepreneurs. She's domain agnostic and phase agnostic. And apart from that, Nandini also writes a weekly column with Your Story. She has written multiple books, the first one being Entrepedia. She has written a second book, which is called Startup Stand Up. And the third book is called Cook-a-Doodle, I think, which also highlights her passion with cooking, if I'm not wrong. Nandini, welcome to the panel. We are so privileged to have you with us.
Thank you very much.
Next, we have Peter with us. Peter and I, obviously, we share a common passion, which is Janajal, which we spoke about, during our rehearsal session. Peter is a founding member of Orthodox Foundation. He's a future-driven catalyst and a serial entrepreneur who is not afraid to take bold ideas, giving data the voice to build a better future for tomorrow. His current ventures are Orthodox, that I mentioned, and Sports Scientia. He also advises companies and entrepreneurs from around the world to build impact-driven and sustainable ventures. And we are so happy, to see the work that we can do together, Peter, at Janajal. Thank you for coming on this panel.
Yeah,
And
sincere pleasure. Yeah,
it's
thank you for having me. Thank you. And to sharing it with the rest of the panel as well.
an Then we have Raghav with us. Hi, Raghav. And Raghav is the partner for Anchor Group, Switzerland. He is, which is a boutique investment firm for Series A, B companies in Europe, USA, and also advises on cross-border market entry and joint venture partnerships. He's a regular. In the past, Raghav has led initiatives to raise $200 million real estate fund, which is called Greenfield. He has also been part of a crack team to structure $250 million infrastructure fund and has been a top management of Brand Capital, which is an initiative by Times of India and which has grown to become a $1 billion program. So congratulations, Raghav, for all the fantastic work that you do, and thank you for being with us today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, and it's a pleasure to be with my co-panelists.
Great. Last but never the least, Nirav. We have Nirav with us. We are so thrilled to have you, Nirav, that you finally made it on time.
Yes, thank you.
Nirav is the co-founder and CEO of Credible. It's a fintech company with a mission to triple the available working capital in India over the next 5 years. Nirav has been an entrepreneur for 22 years and has incubated and scaled businesses, raised debt and equity financing, and built multidisciplinary global teams in the areas of technology, private equity, and international commodity. Nirav has founded several companies in the space of tech and internet and has had three successful exits. He's an active early age investor in tech-enabled consumer-led ventures and has invested in over 25 opportunities till date. Welcome to the panel, Nirav. We are so thrilled to have you with us.
Thank you.
Anuradha, can we kidnap Nirav? Because if he has had three successful exits, he's eminently kidnappable.
I'll happily join you wherever you ask me to. Thank you so much for those kind words. We'll appreciate it.
Thank you. Let's start the discussion. I would like to, first go to Samarendra sir and ask him what is. He has had such a diverse, with Midcat. I've literally seen Midcat running for whatever years that I have, and I've seen him literally cheerleading all the other, organizations. And he has had such diverse experience when it comes to his, the military background or, what he has done for the country. So why don't you start? Because, you've had the longest span and seen how India's entrepreneurial landscape has, how is it growing and where is it going?
So thank you.
She called you older. Don't forget that.
No, not old. He's young at heart.
Thank you very much, Anuradha. And good afternoon to you, all the esteemed panelists, and I can also see my future investor there. So, and the front reader, and of course, the Horasis. I can also see a mentor, and I can see so many people who can be well-wishers and part of the community. So great to be, and also I would like to, a big thank you to Moti, Praveen, Stewart, and Rajiv, Dr. Rajiv Mathur, good friend. So for all of you for joining us. Of course, tell Parag, we missed him.
Yes.
So this conference couldn't have been better timed. So I'll try to stick to my 3 minutes, and Anup. So yep. The conference couldn't have been better timed. I mean, last couple of weeks have been absolutely phenomenal for Indian startups.
Agree.
So we of course, Zomato, everyone has been talking about stellar debut on stock market, 38 times oversubscribed, 50% plus premium, market cap, 1 trillion rupees. Trillion. Okay. So it's the first, but what's more, most important is that it is the first of a generation of internet unicorns to tap India's capital market. And Zomato's success will probably lead to a lot of IPOs, a full boom of IPOs, and that will free up a lot of capital for future unicorns of India. At the same time, the parent of Paytm has filed a draft prospectus for what would be India's biggest IPO at $2.2 billion. Flipkart has raised $3.6 billion at $38 billion valuation. Baijus is already at $16.5 billion valuation. Last year, we had 12 unicorns. This year, in 7 months, we have already had 16, and then many more to go. So last 5 years, if I look at, we had $60 billion of private investment coming into the Indian internet tech space. And the timing just seems to be right, because China is spooking investors with its untimely action against Alibaba and Didi Chaxing. India's 1.3 billion consumers, 650 million internet users, and the vastly underpenetrated and underserved market, it provides a great potential. So that's my point number one. India's time has come. My second point is that, remember, it is not the entrepreneur. It's the ecosystem, stupid, right. If I were to put it in Bill Clinton's word. So, I mean, you need a market, consumer, you need product and prototype manufacturers, you need mentors and incubators and accelerators. I mean, you need companies, you need investors, all kinds of investment. You need Nirav, you need angel, private, institutional, equity, debt. You need logistics, reverse logistics. You need industry, academia, government collaboration. You need favorable regulatory regime. You need great infrastructure. You need product platform. And I can go on and on. So you need a whole lot of things and some outstanding, robust marketing. So the whole ecosystem has to kick in if India is to become a great startup nation. And so we have this happening in Bangalore. And we need more of Bangalores, and we need Bangalores, Mumbais, and Gurgaons to do even better. So that
even tier 2 and tier 3 cities for that matter.
Yes, yes. And then my third and final point, technology and entrepreneurship must be a force for good. And that's why I like companies like Janajal, the social ventures. Beyond the consumers, beyond the consumer internet, beyond the metro cities, beyond the India 1.0 consumers, what I call in big cities. There is a big Bharat where opportunities abound for self-employment, for micro-entrepreneurship, for effective delivery of government and private services over the last mile, women entrepreneurship, social enterprise in aspirational districts. So there is whole lots to do. I have a friend, Raghuraman, who very eloquently articulates that grassroots entrepreneurship leads to much more equitable distribution of both growth as well as profit. So if you have a lady who is selling 15 rupees idli, so she pockets only 3 rupees. Balance is equitably divided in the kirana shop, in the person who grinded that or ground that, and you know, the auto rickshaw guy who brought it to this, and the whole the farmer who grew it. So the whole value chain, everyone gets about 3 rupees each. So he also says that entrepreneurship per square feet is much higher in the SME sector, and their employment potential is just simply phenomenal. So and they are fairly empowered. If you look at this boy who is selling the rose, Raghuta narrates the story beautifully. I mean, he's got 10 rupees and he's 30% and will give you a discount in less than 30 seconds if you want a 30% off. And that will put to shame any guy from Amazon and you know or a Flipkart. So just to summarize, good days are ahead for Indian entrepreneurs. We need job creators and then not only job seekers. So and not only the tech consumer internet space, but also embrace social enterprise, do good to do better. And then finally, we need the full ecosystem to kick in and to make the Indian entrepreneur successful and to make India a great startup nation. So our time has come, Anuradha. Back to you with that.
So happy to hear that. I have a few questions, but I will come to you in the next round, sir. I will move to Nandini now. And Nandini has mentored 5,000 entrepreneurs till date, and she has done such an incredible job at it. I mean, Nandini, I think, you know, what Samrind was talking about was the tangible things, right? Why don't you talk about the mindset, right? Especially in a country like India, where, you know, people are often told to follow a certain path, especially the younger generation. I think what is so exciting about this time is I also see young entrepreneurs. Earlier, we always saw mature entrepreneurs or people, you know, who were at a certain age. But I think what I find most exciting is they're, you know, the early, you know, the young entrepreneurs are there, which makes me very excited because, you know, I feel there's a future for me, right? I don't have to reach to a certain age to be able to do something big, right? And second point, Nandini, that I think, you know, if you could touch upon was, we were talking about women entrepreneurs. We see all these unicorns, but we don't see, unfortunately, we do not see any woman founder there, right? Nykaa seems to be one of them, you know, Falguni Nair, what she's doing, and hopefully, you know, we'll reach an IPO with Nykaa soon. But why don't you talk about why is there so, you know such less women entrepreneurs in the landscape? Over to you, Nandini.
Yeah, thank you, Anuradha. First of all, my definition of startup is like this. It is not, you know, the phase in the life of an organization, meaning it's not a new company, a young company, therefore it's a startup. To me, startup is a cognitive construct, which means it's a mind space, it's an attitude. And there are three elements to this attitude. Number one, when I say somebody thinks like a startup, it means that that person has no baggage, no legacy issues. So what it means is he's able to be nimble-footed, he's able to be fearless because there is no precedent for him. You know, so he's able to be gung-ho about everything that comes in. He's not going to sit down with Excel sheets and write the pros and cons of every single thought and every single idea. That's number one. Number two, being a startup means, having a startup attitude means coming up with solutions, seeing opportunities in situations before the situation becomes a problem itself. Now, that to me is a phenomenal mindset. Pandemic is a good example of what I'm talking about. And number three, coming up with local solutions for local problems. Not doing this typical cut paste. I always give example of Dropbox. 6 years before Dropbox came on the scene, a young kid in one of the small colleges in Kanpur, okay, not even an engineering student, had come up with the idea of Dropbox. Okay, it's just that for whatever reason, many of these things in India don't see the light of the day. Now, is India a startup nation? My answer is yes and no. Yes, to the extent that we have a demographic dividend. You know, we don't just have a mouth to feed and two hands to work. We also come with a bloody brain, you know, and that is a huge demographic dividend. Okay, no, because of two problems, essentially. One, we are still in the cut-paste mode. Bahar se hum yahan leke aate. We try, you know, bringing solutions from outside and force-fit those solutions into local problems. It's a good thing if it works. It's a terrible waste of resources if it doesn't work. Okay. Number two, and more importantly, Indian attitude typically is somebody else will fix the problem. And particularly in India, because we are a democracy, we always think the government is going to fix the problem. It's not the government's job. Let's be very clear about it. Government's job is to govern. We don't allow the government to govern. We expect government to do all kinds of rubbish things. Now, how do we make India an entrepreneurial nation? How do we make India a startup nation? Okay. My answer is very simple. Maybe you will find it, a little too simplistic probably. In class, I have always maintained that entrepreneurship is not a career choice. It's a lifestyle choice. You know, if it's a lifestyle choice and I'm embracing it, not just for my professional space, but for my personal space too, what am I doing different here? Instead of setting and defining goals, you know, from 2 years from now, I should be CEO. 5 years from now, I should earn 1 million. 6 years from now, my company should be a unicorn. Instead of setting these kind of very, very insipid goals, let's say, I would define meaning and purpose in my life. That's how I would go about it. If some, many years ago, in a BBC interview, the guy asked me, what is your philosophy in life? And on the fly, I told him, I said, my tomorrow should be better than my yesterday. And today should be the bridge between yesterday and tomorrow. And I think that's how I have lived my life. Purposefully, meaningfully, and that's why you see the glow on my life, glow on my face, and that's why I don't look 61, right? I started climbing and trekking when I was 53 years old. 1 month ago, we've just started a new Indo-French restaurant in Jaipur. So that's what I mean. This is not about career choice or anything. If India can create an ecosystem for an entrepreneurial mindset, by entrepreneurial mindset, I don't mean all of us toodle off and start our own businesses. But if we can create this mindset that, you know, purpose is more important than goal in life, I think we would at some point become a startup nation. Over to you, Anuradha.
Thank you, Nandini. I think you talked about a boy, you know, who had an idea which was similar to Dropbox but couldn't scale. And I think that also gives a peek into, you know, what this country can do sometimes, you know, in terms of, following a certain educational pattern or, you know, achieving things and not taking risk enough. So thank you for sharing. And I think we'll further.
Just one line I'll add on the women entrepreneurs.
Yes.
Like I said, I think in the last 10, 13 years, we have mentored over 5,500, 6,000 entrepreneurs across the globe. Okay. Across the globe. I'm stressing across the globe to highlight the fact that notwithstanding, we also work in, very mature markets, well-developed economies. The percentage of women entrepreneurs to men is abysmally insignificant. It's not just in India. In India, we have a lot of cultural issues, yes. But why? It is easy, Anuradha, to blame it on the system and say system doesn't encourage women to be entrepreneurs. But having seen students, having seen women mentees, all of that, I've come to the conclusion that we are our biggest enemy.
Okay.
And for whatever reason, we find it far easier to become an employee, to stay a homemaker, to bake chocolates, because when people ask me, what do you do? I've got my engineering degree from IIT. No, not me. I'm saying hypothetically. I've got my engineering degree from IIT and my neighbor asks me, what do you do? I obviously can't say I'm a homemaker. I sit at home. So what do I say? Oh, I have a small business. I bake chocolates at home. And unfortunately, venture capitalists, and I think the people here who deal with equity and, debt know what I'm talking about. We undervalue what we do, okay? And therefore, we give permission to the rest of the society to undervalue us.
Yeah, exactly, Nandini. You know what you're talking about. So I think it is also the cultural conditioning, right? And also, I read this fact which said less than 2% of equity funding in 2017 went to women. And it literally broke my heart to see, that's what this ecosystem is. But together, I think it's just not about women supporting women. Yeah. It's about women supporting men, men supporting women, and women supporting women. I think, that's what we, aim to bring about. I'll move to Peter now. So Peter, like you said, you're working at grassroots levels and with one of my favorite organizations, which is Janajal at the moment. And so what you're trying to do, one thing that this pandemic showed us that when people were able to, access the classrooms, lot of economically vulnerable section couldn't, right? They lost access to schools completely. And I remember you talking about your EdTech project. So if you could shed light on this and how can we make this entrepreneurial landscape more accessible to everyone? And it shouldn't be just bifurcated on the basis of privilege or haves and have-nots. Over to you, Peter.
Yeah, sure. And it's been really interesting hearing what's being said right now. And I'm a core... Ambassador for building ecosystems. I've done it over a 20 plus year lifespan in this whole entrepreneurial journey that I've been on. And likewise, I've had three successful exits of my own, and it's been through pure hard work. But what it's also allowed me to do is to see things in a completely different way. I made many, many, many mistakes. For sure, I made money along the way, but I lost a lot of money along the way as well. The journey for Other Dots, to come back to the question, the journey for Other Dots is really one that I believe that no matter what ecosystem we're building, the foundation of education is absolutely paramount. And what's happened now with this whole pandemic has demonstrated that the academic systems that we have in place don't work. We live in a world that's completely different. Now, I'm not saying that we're coming in to change maths, physics, chemistry, whatever. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that the way we have to learn has to change. And there's one platform that has made the new generation, the young generation of today, and even the older generation today, to become a little bit different in their mindset. And why you're seeing this entrepreneurial shift across all age groups is pure gaming. Playing games allows you to think and react in ways you never ever thought of. Okay? It unlocks the unconscious side of your brain, the subconscious mind. And gaming today, unanimously, is one of the most powerful platforms for change. And, when I keep reading that and listening to podcasts, what's more annoying is that a lot of change that happens in the developed world, the developed nations, where there is money. And my view is, well, what about those who are in the developing nations who don't have this opportunity? People don't know that certain kids can't go to school because they have to work, because they need to put bread on the table. So if there's a family of five or six, everyone has to work. Education is out the window. And I'm saying that's wrong. And if we want to build an ecosystem in any country, but today we're focusing on India. For me, if we need to build an ecosystem that starts with a ground foundation, with a solid base to work from, then we need education to be that paramount point. And education is not just for young kids, okay? It's about those who are also the older generation. So what about if we used, and the way we're terming this is, we want to bring education into the new playground of tomorrow. We want to take academic curriculums that are existing today and embed them in gaming. And there's a powerful platform in the world right now run by Epic called Unreal Engine. And I'm plugging them even though I'm trying to liaise with them, right? But the Unreal Engine is such a powerful piece of technology that allows you to be able to build whatever you want to build. Okay, and you talked about local solutions. I think it was being spoken before, local solutions. That's a great opportunity where, the younger generations, even the elder, can go onto this platform and play out scenarios, build scenarios to help that situation occur. So one of the things we've obviously done, Aljo, is that that's what we want to do. We want to create this platform that allows people to understand why clean water is essential. How do we get to clean water? How do we distribute this clean water? What's the benefits of everything that happens, right? The whole system that works around it. So for me, the educational part is I don't want to go to developing world to prove that gaming is powerful. I want to go to the underprivileged areas, rural areas around India, all right, take kids out of work, put them into schooling. Into schooling, what I mean is through our foundation, all we're asking for people to make contributions of $1. That $1 gets split. And that $1 split because obviously we need to fund the platform for the gaming, but we need to bring the technology. We need the electricity. We need the internet. But at the same time, we want that contribution to go to building the schooling, the housing to put the schools in. Okay. We want to be able to give the parents money so they can not have their kids go to work, to allow them to go to schools. We need to recruit teachers, merging physical with digital. All right. And that's the goal of AbaDots. And we have two case studies that we're going to be working with. One is with Janaljo in India. And then we've got another one with Build Your Future Today in Cambodia. And that's to demonstrate that with, innovation, creativity, mindset, purpose, okay, and with, the donations that will be transparent. So you know exactly where your money's going. And that's another thing that really bothers me around this whole world today, and it's not the subject of today, but the lack of transparency around donations, not knowing where they go. I know where they go because there's $1.1 trillion in the world that gets stolen from countries who are in need of it. And you can just see it today with the whole pandemic. Okay, those who are getting vaccinated, those who are not getting vaccinated, and there's a massive question mark. But that's where education again kicks in for me. So I will stop there because I could just go on for hours. But yeah, I'm very passionate about this subject and everything. So,
and that's so good to hear, Peter. I think you touched upon three very important topics. One was gamification in education. We're seeing the biggest tech giants like Facebook has also, how they're testing gamification at the moment. The second is the ongoing learning, which is important for every entrepreneur. You just can't stop learning because you've graduated right from a college, right? You just, entrepreneurship is such a journey that you got to keep learning. And I think the third thing that you're really currently working on, which is how to enable transparency, while donating money. I think we all have come to a point where we want to donate, but we're not sure if the money is going to be utilized or not. So thank you for your thoughts, Peter. I will move to Raghav now. Raghav has had... he has closed deals worth $250 million USD, and he has also been responsible for Times of India, brand capital. Raghav, why don't you weigh in your thoughts, that how do you think where it is moving and, from your experience?
Yeah, thanks for that, Anuradha. So I would like to talk a bit about how everything is interconnected, right, in this startup ecosystem. I've seen the startup ecosystem very closely in India. I've seen it very closely in Israel. I was a delegate there when we visited a lot of incubators, accelerators, and the government. I'm also a partner in a Swiss fund, which looks at cross-border investments and partnerships. So just to speak about India, I've launched a startup accelerator, which mentors early stage startups, and also an angel network, and also looking at Series A and Series B. So the moot point that I would like to say is that all these are interconnected, right? They are not separate from each other because one leads to the other. And the basic foundation, what I've seen in India, is that the time the startups come for funding, they already have certain perceptions in their mind. And this is what you need to sort at a very early level at the education system. So if you see the education system in India, it is still functioning. The curriculum is still on the old system.
Right.
What we need to introduce is courses around entrepreneurship. This leads to a cultural mindset of entrepreneurship, which is very important from day one. Because as soon as you finish school, I've seen thousands of students, all they want is a good job, right? Very few, if you see the subset of children coming out of school, very few want to become entrepreneurs because that risk-taking culture is not there.
Right.
So I think the first thing we need to do as a nation is introduce these courses in the school curriculum. Second, we need to handhold incubators and accelerators to a much larger extent. because it is in these incubators and accelerators that people get to work on their ideas. They get initial funding, and then they, you know, move about to raise money. So unless we actually support these incubators and accelerators in a larger way, both from the government side and the private sector, you know, the entrepreneurship ideas are, most of them are going to fail because they're just going to remain ideas and they won't get that channel to take it to the next level. So this is the second point I want to make. The third point is that, you know, in India, the VC community broadly fund those, a particular type of student or a particular type of background of a person who's basically coming out of consulting, maybe a McKinsey or a BCG, an IIT or an IIM. So, you know, if you look at the startups that have got funded, you'll find very similar backgrounds of these, you know, startups. So I think it needs to be more broad-based. VCs need to realize that there are a lot of bright ideas out there and bright, you know, individuals out there who are not from these institutions, and we must support them. We also need to create, I think, a culture of correlation between government, university, and corporates. If you look at Silicon Valley and the reasons for its success, or even if you look at Israel, I think all these support each other right from the ideation stage. So, for example, you have co-working spaces in Israel where it is sponsored by companies like Cisco or let's say an Apple or an Intel, where they say, okay, we are going to, you know, sponsor this vertical because this is what we need in our company. And we are going to, you know, go out and sponsor 10 startups and give them space and give them access to our ecosystem within the company. So, you know, there has to be a practical way of taking the idea from ideation to customer engagement, you know, customers, rather than just funding. So I think what we focus on a lot in India and also in other ecosystems is that if you get funded, you are successful. It may not be true, right? Because you might get funded, but maybe you burn the money in 18 months and you no longer exist. So I think some of these critical building blocks need to come into the Indian ecosystem to make it more broad-based and more, you know, successful.
Right. Raghav, I agree to you. You know, you talked about the risk-taking appetite, right? And I think the example that Nandini also mentioned, and I think, you know, that somebody had an idea which was similar to Dropbox, but it couldn't really, you know, take the risk or jump into it because of the whole system, you know, that we nurture here. And I think another very important point that you mentioned was that how most of the funding goes to, you know, people who are from a certain, you know, brand of institutes, right? Like Zomato, the founder is from Bain Consulting, right? I mean, just because it's so fresh in, you know, each of our minds. So, yeah, I agree to what you're saying. And I think we'll, you know, take the discussion to Nirav now. And, you know, Nirav is successfully, he has successfully built company and he's, you know, co-founder of Credible. Nirav, why don't you, you know, weigh in your thoughts on the topic, please?
Right. Thank you, Anuradha. I think the panelists have made some super points. But I think as an entrepreneur, let me share with you five key lessons I have learned, right, over the last 20 odd years that I've happened to build businesses. The first one, and I allude to what you just said, Nandini, is you know, a lot of us think that it's, you need to have great domain expertise before you go out and venture on your own. And I'm here to say that that's, you know, in my opinion, that's completely irrelevant. The first business I set up was right out of my university sophomore year. It was a tech and product services business, and I had absolutely no idea about services or product or tech. The next one, 10 years later, was a global commodities and structured finance business trading in Indonesian thermal coal. And from being a technology entrepreneur to someone going and spending hours in mines and overnight in Indonesia and Jakarta trying to understand how coal works, again, had no relevance to what I knew about commodities. And then eventually, when today we're building India's largest working capital platform, is a far-fetched cry from shipping coal all over the world. So, you know, I would think that entrepreneurs should not get stuck with this whole vision about being domain experts. As long as they want to transform the space that they are interested and passionate about, it's probably better not to know that space really well, because then you can think differently. So that's the first.
It would be limiting. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the first one. The second one that I've heard, you know, commonly seen a lot of young entrepreneurs talk about is being a unicorn, creating, you know, raising money at 4x, 5x every round. I've chased that dream too. And I've quickly realized that if you focus on building value and transformation, on transforming a space, then valuation will follow. So that's the second thing I've learned. The third thing I've learned is, you know, growth and success is not really in the things that are external and sort of materialistic. I have always seen that growth and success come through relationships. So the way you manage relationships, whether it's internal with your employees, with your teammates, with your co-founders, investors, or externally with customers and partners and financiers and so on and so forth, really determine the success. It's how people talk about you. It's how people think about you. And it's how comfortable people are around, you know, having you versus your competitor in that ecosystem. So I think relationships are very key to anything that I have built so far in my life. I think if you look at all of this, and a lot of times people say, I have a great idea. And I personally believe that ideas are cheap because I get one every 10 minutes. What really, really matters is execution at the end of the day. So, and execution is never individualistic. So it's execution is a function of the team that you build. It is the function of the empowerment that you give that team. And it's also a function of, like I said, the ecosystem around you. So these are a few things that, you know, over the last, one last thing. I have always believed that a success of an entrepreneur is not in how many few mistakes that person makes. I've made, like Peter said, I've made thousands of mistakes in my life. But what I've learned over the years is the success of a great entrepreneur is how quickly he's able to kind of course correct. And I think entrepreneurs are very scared of making big mistakes. I'm very scared of making small mistakes and lingering on with them. So I think that's been a great learning for me. So if I think about today's India's entrepreneurial ecosystem, a lot of these things get overlooked. People talk about changing the way consumers think, etc. Of course, I mean that really what creates value, but all of these things are important in my view. So that's my two bits.
Thank you so much, Nirav. I think you talked about domain expertise, and that is so important because I follow this person called Naveen Jain, and he talks about how the disruptors are never from the same category. They always come from a different category because they can look at a problem differently, right? So thank you so much, Nirav. I think that was a crash course for me in entrepreneurship personally. So, thank you for those pointers.
Can I just add one thing? Sorry to butt in, sorry, but I think one clarification for me with entrepreneurship is that, we're seeing it today that everyone's become an entrepreneur, everyone becomes a mentor, everyone's become an advisor, an investor, an angel investor, et cetera, et cetera. And I think if there's one part that needs to be addressed here is that for me personally, an entrepreneur is part of your DNA. You have it. You've got to have it. Now, sometimes it comes out at a very young age. Sometimes it comes out at an older age. But at some point in time, your entrepreneurial, instinct will happen. I don't think entrepreneurship is one where you graduate from a university and suddenly say, right, I'm going to become an entrepreneur, okay? Because you've got to have it. You've got to have this appetite for losing money, appetite for making taking huge risks, okay? The appetite of having nothing in your pocket and knowing what to do to make these mistakes we've all made. But how do I address it? And do I have the capability of building a team that resonates everything around what I'm trying to do? So,
Hi, look who has joined us. Hi, sir, how are you?
Hi, everyone. I am so sorry, I'm just jumping in, but this is not, I tried so hard to resist not jumping in, bomb this room, but, this topic is so dear to my heart. And, Peter said something which kind of got me, provoked me. He says, an entrepreneur is not someone who waits to graduate and then decides to become an entrepreneur. I want to add to that and say an entrepreneur is one who will never graduate. They are backbenchers. They are ones who've repeated and they're often dropouts. So they're not waiting for that curriculum to end upon them to really go out and then test themselves. They're going to go and challenge the world and say that, you know, here I am, take me on. So, all right, I can speak forever, but thank you for this opportunity. I love this session. I wish that I could rename this the plenary, the top plenary of Horace's India Movement. All my favorite people here. Nandini, already a huge fan. I love what you say. I love what you do. I know about you. And, you know, love you guys. Yeah. I mean, thank you for just doing this.
Thank you. Thank
you. Bye-bye. I'm so charged right now. So, you know, thank you.
Anuradha.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Some lessons I learned from Parag, you know, and you know.
It's becoming more like a family WhatsApp group right now.
One is that there has to be a fundamental mismatch between resource and ambition. You can't say, I don't have money, I don't have this, I don't have that. And it has to have a value and purpose because beyond making you rich and famous.
Right.
But this is the whole concept.
You have to be extremely focused, and this I didn't learn from Parag Agrawal, this I learned from Anurag Agrawal. You know, do less to do more. My chairman also says, and we have some amazingly successful entrepreneurs here. Jayesh Parekh is there.
You know, I'm loving this panel because everybody is waiting to talk. And
Wait. One more thing. In the lighter end.
Yeah.
You know, another hidden or a very subtle advantage in the world of entrepreneurship is the surname or the community called Agarwal.
Yeah, give me a high five.
I have to say this because the Bansals, the Goyals, the Agarwals, and all the likes are eventually.
Sir, that is categorization which we shouldn't do.
Sorry, I didn't mean to be.
One last thing, you know, cash is queen. I learned this, or king, whatever you want to say.
Queen, let's call it queen.
Let's call her queen. Yeah.
We don't mind you being sexist. No problem.
Sex, yeah. Cash is queen because top line is vanity, bottom line is sanity, and cash is reality. So cash is also very, very important. And yes, my final bit is, about people, because just once I met Jaswant Singh, you know, and he says, Sam, the graveyards of the world are full of people who thought they were indispensable. So amazingly, you know, differentiate or die, stay focused, do less to do more. It's all about the three C's, the customers, colleagues, and culture. That eats, obviously, strategy for breakfast. As somebody had said, fail fast, fail forward. And rule of three, final. Whatever you think will take three times more. Time, effort, money. Okay. So just be kind of. So those are my bit of learnings. Thank you.
You know, sir, my mentor told me once, if you have to fail fast. And that mentor happens to be on the panel today. So he knows who I'm referring to. So, yeah, I completely agree to, you know, what you're saying. And we just have 2 minutes left. And anybody who has any last thoughts on the topic, and
we have some amazingly successful entrepreneurs in the audience. I think anyone can, you know.
I think we have had the highest engagement, honestly.
I would say this, and I'll say this in a real respectful way, as a non-Indian here, you guys are the startup nation. You guys are that foundation that need to drive this. You know, there's so much passion here. You know, and I've traveled the world many, many, many times, okay? And, you know, this for me is why I love the whole entrepreneurial part. And this is why I want to go into the trenches, to go in there, because I just think this passion that you guys have here, and with Parag, who's just joined in, that to me is the startup nation. This is the epitome of what needs to happen, right? And if you can embed
I disagree. Sorry, can I just say? Yes. I disagree with you completely, Peter.
You do? Why?
The reason is, number one, what you see in India is not passion. What you see here is animation. Because all our languages are very loud decibels, and we cannot speak without using our bodies.
That's so a Mediterranean thing, too.
Okay, number one. No, number two, and I'm making a valid point now. I think passion has an overrated association with entrepreneurship. When I hear somebody say, to be an entrepreneur, you need passion, my counter argument always is, to live, you need passion. You cannot live passionless. So what is so special about entrepreneurship? Absolutely nothing.
Somebody else wants the mic.
Yes, founder of Sony Entertainment Television. Jayesh, right.
Yeah, Jayesh has... Hi, Jayesh. Welcome to the panel.
Last is, look, you must have the risk-taking ability, number one. Number two, you must have a 360-degree view of your world. And number three, you must have absolutely impeccable executive decision-making skills. And so I see all these friends of mine. Nirav, good to see you as well. Raghav, good to see you. Sam, thank you. But excellent panel. Really enjoyed it. Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
All
right. Thank you.
Thank you,
Jayesh. Thank you.
Jayesh bhai has been a mentor to me since I started my Calcutta.
Yeah, mentors are just coming 9 years. In. What a good day. Thank you, all of you. We are, you know.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Let's all stay in touch.
Yeah, let's stay in touch. Yes. Anuradha, you have all our numbers. So why don't you create a WhatsApp group so that we all stay in touch?
And I'd love to see how I can help.
Thank you, Priti.
With whatever I can do my side.
Definitely. Yes, definitely. Okay. Thanks.
No good morning messages on this WhatsApp.
Yeah, of course. I think those are only for family WhatsApp groups. Yeah.
Okay. Bye, bye, guys.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.